But we begin this morning with a debate over whether limousines are structurally sound enough in the aftermath of a crash with a pickup that killed four young women in the prime of their lives. TV 1055's Jennifer McLogan has more.
A week of anguish for Smithtown, Long Island families. Tearful mourners again gathered on this day to honor and celebrate the life and accomplishments of 23-year-old Stephanie Belly as the last of the four young friends killed in the North Fork limousine tragedy was laid to rest.
A clearer but not yet complete picture of what occurred on that day is emerging.
During a media briefing, the district attorney revealed the blood alcohol level of pickup truck driver Stephen Romeo as 0.06, below the 0.08 legal standard for driving while intoxicated. It was taken an hour and 40 minutes after the crash. Prosecutors are not reducing the DWI charge.
At the time of the crash, the defendant's blood alcohol was most likely over 0.08.
Drug testing is not yet completed, or accident reconstruction, looking at speed, cell phone activity of both drivers, any other distractions based on further witness testimony. Romeo's attorney spoke by phone, denying their client was drunk, saying he remains in the hospital devastated.
It's a tragedy all around, but the limo driver made a three-point turn. He made that U-turn.
They take these limousines and they just stretch them.
Victor DiPaola is a retired NYPD sergeant living on the North Fork. He says he and his neighbors are concerned about limousine safety. Big town cars converted into stretch limos, worried they're not crash-worthy, stripped of safety features, reconfigured and modified, asking if those in the middle are sitting ducks. The limousine did have seat belts. It's unclear if any of the young women were wearing them or if it would have made a difference. The DA says he will be interviewing the four survivors as soon as they are physically and emotionally able. From Southold, Jennifer McLogan, TV 1055.
And joining us now is a critic of limo design coming from an unusual corner. He is Tom Daly, head of the Aviation School at Dowling College, and welcome to the show, Mr. Daly.
Thank you for having me.
Now, you've come out for tougher limo reinforcements publicly, but as they say, you're coming at it from the aviation business. But you've had some past dealings with this issue yourself. Explain.
Well, I was a police helicopter pilot for Nassau County Police for 32 years.
So you would respond to crash scenes.
Unfortunately, you saw incidents
like this? Describe what you saw.
Well, the stretch limos, that accidents that I went to, did cave on the sides. I'm familiar with three terrible accidents that occurred on Long Island. All were multiple fatalities.
Yeah, they really made an impression on you. It's made this a mission for you, well, from what you've seen.
Well, sure. I would like to see the NTSB take a closer look. While they are an independent agency, they would hopefully provide the suggestions that would lead to controls.
The National Transportation Safety Board.
Yes.
You wouldn't normally expect them maybe to do limousines, but this has become more and more prevalent in our society, these bigger and bigger limousines.
Well, they buy a limousine and then they cut it in half and put a section in the middle, and they can make it two or four times larger than its intended purpose.
So, you know, this is where they would put in, like we've seen, hot tubs in pool and cars, right. Virtual pools. People have bars in there. They have a separate sitting area. It's like, a nightclub on wheels.
And the seats face the sides. There's not a lot of control over the airbags, if they even have them. They answer to their own safety standard.
So there's not as many airbags as you might expect in your own vehicle, or is it because there's so many people in there?
If any, to answer to a lateral crash.
Now, what about seat belts? Are they required in limousines?
They are required, but again, sitting sideways, impact from different angles. Most people expect the frontal impact. That's not necessarily the case with these type of vehicles.
And they're getting longer and longer, am I right? Because, I mean, some of these are beyond stretch limos, some of them. They can, be almost impossible for them to make a turn.
Well, they can't negotiate a standard U-turn. Often in that particular intersection, when I looked at it, many of the limos have to make a three-point turn.
And what does that mean? They got to back up?
Correct. They spend a considerable amount of time looking at traffic.
Well, I passed one time where I had to veer around to the right. And, that can happen with any vehicle, so we're not trying to pick on limousine industry here.
No.
Because they have a going business that people want. But, this appears to really be a serious issue. What would you like to see done about it?
Well, I'd like to see the NTSB take a closer look at the safety standard that exists for them. There is a New England company that claims that they answer to a safety standard, but there's no measure, there's no way to see that it's continued even if it were properly built, after it leaves there.
Do people wear their seatbelts in limousines?
I do, but I'm told most don't.
You were quoting that you've seen statistics that only half, and yet we have in our society, almost everybody puts a seatbelt on now when they get in their own vehicle.
And the surprising number of fatalities to people in the back seat without seatbelts is probably over 50%.
Now, why are they getting this sense of comfort that they don't put a seatbelt on once they step into one of these luxurious limos?
Well, it's a good time that they're out to have. Probably the focus is less on safety than it is on the actual event. And most people expect the front collision. So in a stretch limo, you're considerably far away from the front.
And we see from here that was the side collision. A pickup went right through there, killing four women and seriously injuring others. And so the middle of the limousines, does more need to be done there? Do they have reinforcing bars there?
They have vertical reinforcement bars and cross sections of reinforcement. But apparently, from the looks of the limousine accidents I'm familiar with, they didn't do the job.
Now, what about road design? Because these limos are going down these narrow country roads where you could be just as likely to pull up behind a tractor going 15, 20 miles an hour. The speed limits are much lower. But here come these big vehicles from the city trying to make what, you know, some people would be like city moves.
The road's fairly wide, but again, in the world of aviation, in a safety course we teach at Allen College, we address not just aviation. Safety is not owned only by aviation, by the motor vehicle industry as well.
Well, we're not seeing this vineyard tour business go away anytime soon.
No,
it's a
sir.
Booming one that they count on. So do they have to revisit whether or not lights are needed on all of these stretches where vineyards are?
This particular area had a flashing light, but the past accidents, a light may not have helped them in this case, because crossing traffic and the side impact is what led to the fatality.
And it's so sad, because these are events people are celebrating. You saw one where it was a wedding, right?
Yes, sir. Early on in my career, there was one in Lido, crossing over, making a left turn into the beach club where they were going to hold a reception an hour after their wedding. The bride, the groom, and the best man were all killed.
Instead, turns to tragedy, the question being whether or not we can do more to prevent such tragedies from occurring again. Tom Daly, the head of aviation at Dowling College, thanks for stopping in and talking with us about this today.
Thank you.